Okay, welcome back. Second talk. This is Domen Kožar. He's since about 2009 into packaging. Think in the Google Summer of Code project, get introduced working in the Gentoo tooling. Since about 8 years in the Python community, since about 2 years contributing to Nix, and he's talking today about the state of Python packaging and how that reflects in Nix.
Hey everyone. I hope you have stretched and got coffee near wake. I'm going to talk a little bit about how terrible packaging is in Python and how we're slowly fixing that in Nix and in Python community. I assume you know a little bit of Nix. I assume you know almost nothing about Python. And if you have any questions during the talk, please ask. It's easier than at the end. So just raise your hand and I'll repeat the question. So for just a bit of outline, we go through history, how setup.py works, what are the caveats in packaging, how build Python package works, then what the caveats in Nix, and you know what's next from my perspective. So a bit about history. There was these two tools, and still is. And this is how the packaging looks like in these tutorials. You have this setup function that does everything you can think of. And you tell it some metadata and what are the modules. And then you can install that in Python, and it will store it in a special path. More about that later. You can build C extensions. You can create a tarball. So it does everything, of course. So this tutorials was very, very basic. It was mainly meant for building and installing stuff, but it doesn't know about downloadings, dependencies, and it doesn't know about dependencies at all. There is no way to reproduce an installation. You're just like imperative commands, and hope everything works. And it was included into Python in 2000. So a long time ago. And then setup tools came 4 years later, and it's using the same interface. In fact, it monkey patches these tools in order to provide that support. So, you have this easy install command that will fetch from the Python packaging index, that's the central repository for packages. You have this binary format, which is a zip file, and you compile all the C extensions and it zips them up. You can also use all the distutils commands, but it's monkey patches distutils, so it's even, the situation is even worse. It doesn't support uninstall. It's the worst code I've read. At least in 2009, I haven't touched it since because I don't want to. And in 2009 there was no release for years, so that was pretty depressing area in packaging, and still we do everything from setup.py and it handles the state of the world, just to show you how bad this is and was, is install actually for each dependencies it would fetch the description, and then for every link that was in the description it would go to that page and find the possible tarball release. So not only going to the packaging index, it would try to crawl the internet for more releases, which is like what? The install times were really terrible, and you later see that this was fixed only 2014, and there was a lot of politics around whether this kind of backwards compatibility should be kept or not. So this is why everything is going slow, because once you give something to the people, they don't want it. They don't want it that you take that from them. So then in 2007, iBeking, which is not working for Mozilla, he wrote a virtual end, which is kind of like Nix shell for Python. It symlinks Python into a folder test in this case, and then you can install the Python packages in isolated way. And he wrote pip, which is kind of a fork of easy install. Which was a really nice move because you want the installer software to be separated from the build in languages, and it has a nice interface. It has like phases it can freeze versions of independencies and so on. And then Tariq Ziad in 2008, which also now works for Mozilla, basically said, okay, we have to fix this. And, you know, again, after lots of politics, he forked, set up tools and wrote distribute, tried to document stuff and improve that code base, but he, and then the same year, figured out the only way is to rewrite. And finally, I think this is, at least as far as I know, the first actual implementation of static metadata in Python using setup.cfg file. So you would have a static file that, you know, can be parsed and stored and so on, instead of evaluating setup.py every time. But in 2012, he pretty much stepped down. There is a long story around that, and it's not really that important, but the end result is that distutils was pretty much left alone, and distribute at least got merged back into setup tools. So people are very confused. We had like setup tools, distributes, the distutils too, and then that merges back and forth. So a lot of effort and you know, some results, but still not that good. And then that was the area where people actually started to talk, and they said, okay, now we have to start with specification first and discuss things before we go and implement that. So in 2012, that's when it happened. And then after 2012, a lot of PEPs came, and PEPs are Python enhancement proposals. They're pretty much how to improve Python. So there's like a lot of stuff that came after that. And, you know, we're really thankful to all the people that are working on that. And now it's a community effort. But you see there, the metadata 2.0, that's the static metadata format, is still a draft. And all the PEPs that follows are pretty much like specific parts of that metadata. So it's going kind of slow, but that's how we want it to be. We don't, you know, we've tried to rush it and it failed, so that's the only way. Setup.py. This is, you know, a typical a call of that function. You know, there's not much here to. I'll talk about specific parts later, but. You know, you have like entry points at the bottom where you specified what executables to generate. You have different kind of dependencies, some metadata, and that's pretty much it. So then Python, actually, how it finds the packages is using the Python path. And this is an example of the PBR package. You see it all depends on setup tools and on Python, of course. And then if you actually run the Python and import syspath, that's like what Python interprets from that Python path, and you'll see it adds a bunch of Python related paths. And at the top you see it's an empty string, so that's the current directory. And it's, so when you import a package, it goes from the top, from the bottom, and tries to find a module or a folder, a file or a folder, and run that. That's very simple. But you know, so there are a lot of things that are bad. I'll just talk of some of those. We could have a few hour talk just on this topic. But you know, so we have three different basically graphs of dependencies. Setup requires build time, runtime, and optional. And you see there's like even the for starters, even the names, sometimes they have S at the end and sometimes not. So yeah, I always miss that. And you know, another thing is the extras include the testing, but there is no like convention what the testing set should be called. And some people call it test, some people call it testing, and so on. These are all the things that make it really hard to parse this. And we have three separate directed cyclic graphs, so I'll talk about why that's hard in X a bit later. So we have in Python supports circular dependencies, of course, and that's pretty much because pip, the installer that everyone uses, runs in phases. So it will first download everything, and then it will run on all the packages, the build command, and then on all the packages, install command, and then it doesn't run tests at all. So all phases are for the whole package set. And that's why it can do these kind of things. But you know, in Nix, this is problematic because we install packages as a one unit and build them as a one unit. And there are not easy ways to go around circular dependencies. That one is, you know, to bootstrap something like we do for you know, the standard environment, and something we have to do for pip and similar. And the other way is to do this kind of Nix stuff, like, you know, B depends on A, but, you know, in this case, it doesn't depend back on B, and so on. So if there is one thing I want you to remember from this talk, it's this: in Python, tests are the single source of truth. If you don't run tests, you don't know what you packaged. You know, you packaged a bunch of things you never really ran, and you know, because everything is at runtime. You know, even our packaging, the tests are the only way to really test something happen. So you know, when you package Python stuff, always. The most of the effort goes into making sure that these tests actually execute. And if a single test fails, we don't want to disable the whole test suite. We want to disable that test and leave others be there. But a lot of times the source, this doesn't come with tests. A lot of times people use mocking in Python, so if you upgrade a dependency, there is no guarantee that it will, you know, work, even though we have tests. And you know, people try to do everything in tests, and you know, it's a lot of effort, as I said, goes into fixing those things. You know, people have even do things like, you know, run this command and it succeeds in 200 milliseconds. But when you run these things on Hydra, you know, that because of the I/O, that's not a guarantee. So a lot of time we have to disable those tests. Also, like Python versioning, we have currently supported our 2.7, 3.3, 3.4, 3.5, and I think 3.3. Yeah, that's it. So you know, a lot of versions to support, and then you know, Nix has to support all of them. Then and the way that in packaging metadata, we declare this what's supported is with classifiers. But the problem is, no one uses that, or it's you know, it's outdated. So nobody is using that information to automate. You know, the metadata to say, okay, I'm gonna support our build based on these classifiers. So there is no this feedback loop. At least I haven't seen it. So the only way to support that is really to look up the documentation and really specify manually what the Python versions are supported. So it's not too much work, but we have to do it for every package. All right. So the next thing is the manifest file, which is kind of important in packaging, and it basically specifies what files to include besides the Python files. So if you have like icons or anything basically that your program uses, and you know, usually you would say, okay, you would just create a package and say graphed my package, and everything under that will be included into the tarball, but you know, people don't want to maintain that file because a lot of time they will forget to add something, they will deploy, and you know, there will be an icon missing. So they made like this package that a lot of people use, setup tools git. So like it will use git to list all the files in the git to know what are the things that belong to this project. But that means we depend on .git folder in build and install time, and you know, we know that in Nix it's we have problems because it's not that deterministic. So that's sometimes a bit of a pain, but it's something to be careful about. And you know, just so you get an idea what can be in setup pi, you know, people do a lot of stuff. A lot of times things like this, so they will check the current interpreter for what version it is and include argparse. And this is because argparse was added in Python 2.7, so they will declare on dependency on argparse for Python 2.6. And this is a problematic because if you run setup pi with different versions of Python, you will get a different metadata. So that makes things even more complicated. Or they will even do things like this, you know, like try to import it and then depend on it. And PEP 496, which is from this year, actually adds these environment markers. So for every dependency, you can like add a bit of like what under what environment this should be true. So you know we're progressing. It's not that bad. And just to give you an idea how bad this can be, Pillow is a Python imaging library, and you know it's like almost 1,000 lines, and you know it tries to run brew, and it tries to find the prefix from brew, and if it's there, it will add some paths where it should find stuff, and so on. And this is for different Linux distributions; they have hard-coded stuff where it finds. So it's you know anything can be in setup pi, and you know really, I don't see much contributions to this, and it's something we should improve and something we should talk about. But that's the current state. All right, so enough about that. So now we move into how Nix supports Python and what can be done to improve that. And I'm going to go through all the build Python package source codes really quickly because it's very small. Just so that, you know, maybe it will scare you away, but maybe that will give you a bit of an insight on what's going on, and hopefully we'll get more contributors. So I skipped the first lambda function of dependencies because I'll explain all the all the arguments throughout the source. So first we throw this error if the disabled flag is specified, and that's per you know if a specific version of Python is not supported, and that's you know it's a little bit abusing Nix, but I think it's nice because it gives you, you know, the name of the package and under what version is not supported, so it's user friendly. All right, and then we define the Python function, make derivation. We remove the disabled flag because we don't need it anymore. We inherit the do check, and do check is always true in Python, so we always run the test. As I said, that's the most important thing. We have the name prefix, so it will prepend Python and the version before every package. We add a bunch of helpers. We have this line that automatically adds zip as a dependency, unzip. Sorry, if the source is zip, and then we add the propagated build inputs with setup tools always included. All right, and then the configure phase. This is the we export the deterministic build. This makes sure that the Python compiled files don't include timestamps. It's there, so we can disable it. But I guess nobody will ever do that. Here comes the fun part. We basically have to import setup tools before these tools because setup tools fetches these tools, so it has to be imported first. That's how we do it. There are better ways to do it by first importing setup tools and then evaluating setup pi, but yeah, that's how we currently do it, and it kind of works. And pip does the same thing, by the way, if you look at the source. Then the check phase is just setup pi tests. The field phase runs setup pi build with a bunch of flags and all the hooks. All right, and then the install function, that's kind of the meat of it. It creates the site packages, that's where the Python packages are installed. It exports the Python path and then calls setup pi install with a bunch of flags. And then it will move a bit of files and remove them, because if you have isInstall.path in every package, it will conflict when you install two packages into the same environment. So we move it and rename it. And there is one flag that you see there, old and unmanageable, and I'll talk about a bit later, and that's something we have to get rid of. All right, then is the fix-up phase. This is where we wrap all the Python. All the executables in bin are wrapped with the propagated build inputs, basically, because they expect those Python packages to be available. And then we use this .pth files, and I'll talk about those a bit later. That's what that's what this snippet does. And then we have this shell hook, which if there is a setup.py file, it will run setup.py develop, so it will actually like enable you to it enables you to develop Python software, and you will have that, you know, installed and importable. It's not that nice, but it works really well. So I forgot to explain about the PTH files. So this is a kind of hack in Python, because if you just say, if you point Python path to just one package, like, you know, Django, it will use these PTH files to discover all the other packages, so that it will recursively import all the other packages, so you don't have to always specify the whole dependency tree. And so that makes Python path kind of auto-discoverable. I didn't write this, but I don't know if it's a good idea, but that's what we currently have. Caveats and next. We don't support namespaces because of that old and unmanageable flag. And you know, we will see stuff like, you know, this, the init files collide. And you know, what's really going on is that setup tools has this, if in this init file you can say declare namespace, so that way it knows that the logilab package can come from the logilab folder can come from different packages, which is a terrible idea in my opinion, but it's a feature that people use. It's not encouraged anymore, but still there are packages out there. And so the way to currently fix that is just to ignore collisions, and these files will just, you know, merge, and it should work more or less. But we are going to support that with Rios, and I'm going to talk about it a little bit later. Okay, that's another thing that, you know, not only Python has a problem with, but if you have two different versions in the graph, the first one in the Python file will be used, and we won't conflict. And again, that's because of the old and unmanageable flag. And again, this will be improved with the wheel support, so that we at install time, you know, this will be detected. And then the imperative package management. If you do things like okay, install NumPy and Python, import, you know, you will get that it's not available, and that's because we in profiles we don't populate the Python path. You have to specify it yourself. And you know, this is up for discussion. If this is a good idea or not. I think if we pollute the Python path in profiles, it's a bit problematic, because it's, you know, Python, if you'll do anything, it will also find those packages. So if you're not using a change root or something to build stuff, you're gonna leak stuff, and Python won't build or detect that it needs something, and so on. But you know, I have an opinion about this, but I'm easy. You know, somebody wants to convince me, I'm up for discussion. Okay, so a bit. So now a little bit about what problems rise up when you package stuff. And you know, one of the things is that Python 3 doesn't have a Python binary, so a lot of packages assume there is a Python binary. So currently, we just replace the Python with Python interpreter, which is the full path to the binary, and that's sometimes needed. Then we have stuff like the tests will depend actually on the installed files, and because check phase comes before the install phase in Nix, this is a bit problematic. But you can say okay, skip the check phase, do install check phase, which comes after, and you can kind of export the path and run the tests, and that kind of happens a lot of times. Then we have another thing that sometimes interpreters already ship with a library. So for example, enum 3.4 comes in Python 3.4. So you want to only include it before that. And it's problematic because you will get very weird errors if you don't do that, because people don't assume you would install it on 3.4, for example, and you'll see it's just not supported there. Those are the things that are really hard, because you get a very weird error message if you don't do it. And something similar is for PyPy, which is an alternative implementation of Python in Python itself. It ships with this CFFI library. So if you add that dependency, it will pick it. PyPI will pick it up, and because it's not it won't use the internal one. You will get conflicts because the released version might be different from the one that ships with PyPI, and you'll get again very weird stuff. Yeah. Yeah, I mean. Yeah, you could in. Yeah, so the question is, can we do this more automatic? And yes, of course, in the build Python package, we could, you know, say if the PyPI, if we have the PyPI interpreter, then skip these things. Yeah.
Well, this is well. It's kind of questionable whether to use this. Well, in built inputs, it will work, this technique, but not if you, for example, use it in string substitutions.
Yes,
so,
exactly.
So yeah, well, I always don't know whether to use this technique, like for this Darwin stuff.
Yes.
Iconf and such, but.
That's one of the problems. If you use null, then if you use that package in a string, you will get a confusing error message, and that's why I prefer not to do that. But we could filter it out or something. It's definitely something that can be improved, in the Python packaging. So there is another thing that Python, when it reads files from the file system, it will do that based on locale. So a lot of times you will get like a Unicode error in tests, and then you have to do something like this to depend on locales and export that. And you know, it's, yeah. And a lot of times people will like hard code, you know, exact version, and then most of the time the solution is to un-hard code it, but not always. It kind of depends on what they're trying to do, of course. All right, and Python ships with some built-in modules that are we package them separately because, for example, TK inter depends on X, so you don't want the whole X dependency tree. So there's a packet separately. So then you just use Python modules dot curses and tricky part is that we built Python 3 as a whole and Python 2 is modularized. So that's something to improve there also. And you have to be careful which version you use. And in Python 3, actually all the modules are defined as null. So. All right, so, you know, lots of stuff to improve. I haven't had too much time, but at least slowly we're getting somewhere also in the next. So this is something I'm going to work on sprints, and if somebody's interested to help out. I think to get a prototype, it shouldn't take more than a few days, probably a day or two. It's going to be a bit more work to fix all the packages that break. So what are Wheels? Wheels is... basically the next generation egg, and it's a well-defined standard in Python documented when we build a package and we put it into a zip file, how, you know, where everything is and where it's the metadata and where the stuff that should be installed and scripts and so on. So in other words, this is what will effectively change. But why we want to do this is because the Python packaging is where the most improvements happen. So we want to use the latest upstream, where we get all the candies, and this will fix, as I said, like a lot of bugs. And then, you know, someday we probably want to generate packages, but because there is no static metadata, that's really hard. So this is one part. Where we could research how much that metadata we can extract in in a like a central repository or something. So it's easier to then from that static metadata to generate all the packages. But you know, as you saw before, it's really hard to do that, and it's gonna be need a lot of work. And mostly we'll have to work with upstream, so that's kind of a lot of effort to do. Contrary to Haskell or something, where they only have the static files and they can just use those. And you know, I think the Haskell API in terms of Nix is really nice now. It's not perfect, but it's way better than Python. So I think we should move also there with Python, and I think in general all the languages that we have, we should strive to have kind of similar APIs, so not everyone is doing their own thing. So, and I think Haskell is currently the most, you know, advanced and simple at the same time. So that's something to do. So yeah, that's a quick overview. At the bottom there are two links. The first one is the guide about Python packaging in general. It's very well written, and it has the latest, you know, recommended tools and you know, ways to package. And the second one is a bit of a reference manual I wrote for Python, and it's not perfect, and you know, feel free to tell me what's missing, and I'll do my best. And the first line is just from the Python. That's actually one of the guidelines, so I don't know what it means, but yeah, thanks.
Questions?
Okay, so one thing that's not completely clear to me, so you mentioned a new wheel format, and you also mentioned that static descriptions would be good. So the new wheel format, does that still use setup.py, or does that have a static description?
So, well, kind of both. It still uses setup.py, but it will generate the static metadata and put it into the wheel. So only once you've built it, you will have that. So that's a bit too late for us to use. That's meant more like for people doing stuff on, you know, build packages and trying to figure out stuff later on. But the static metadata is something that's still in draft mode, and it's currently not used anywhere. OpenStack people have their own PBR package which does that, and you know, the effort is very fragmented, but we cannot use that, so we'll you know, again, have to do it our way somehow to
so
find.
It wouldn't really be possible to take a wheel file and generate a Nix expression out of that.
Yeah, that's what actually Florian Friesdorf did last year. And that's one way to do it. But the problem is, as I said before, if you run setup.py with different Python versions, you get different dependency graphs. So it's not that simple. You know, that's just one problem that's there. So we still have to run this script to generate the metadata, and it's dynamic, and it's based on environment and so on. So yeah, you might not get everything you need from that.
So next question from Rock.
There is one problem also, which you forgot to mention, is, and especially if you package any command line tool, because of this recursive thing, and the Python path is actually created at runtime. So if you have a command line utility, it would actually run a lot slower, because it will need to figure it out, the whole Python path. And it's quite performance boost, hit when you do this.
Yeah.
So the only way, because it's basically at the build time, you know the Python path, what are my old dependencies, why just not use it? You know, like just set it, because it's, you know about it. So it's like this recursive thing, no, that's not how Python works. That should be removed.
Yeah, I agree. The PTH hack is you know, Nix specific, and it's a hack, and yeah, it has drawbacks, and I if you would ask me, I would remove it, but you know, that's something we should talk about also.
We have more questions?
No, it's all clear. That's good.
So you said that quite often these Python packages, so metadata like the compatibility with specific Python versions is incorrect or incomplete, right?
Yeah.
So does Python do any continuous builds? I mean, what's their CPAN called? Is that PyPy or?
PyPy. No, there is no. They actually don't run that because it's a script, so they specifically don't run setup.py. So the index doesn't even know about dependencies because they don't want to run, you know, arbitrary code on there. So it's pretty much just like description there, and that's pretty much it. And you know, it's problematic because if you like the way you generate the whole dependency tree is Python is like if you depend on Django, you say okay, then you fetch Django, you run the setup.py, then you know the first list of dependencies, and then you have to download all these packages and run setup.py to get more, and so it's, you know, you discover the dependency tree based on how you run these setup.py files. So that's why we want to go to the static metadata, but it's a lot of effort and a lot of people don't want that because, you know, it will break stuff, of course, and so on. So it's, yeah.
So I guess we should sort of infiltrate PyPy to sort of provide kind of Hydra as a continuous build surface for PyPy. And once Python developers depend on that, they will automatically fix their bugs and we don't have to do it.
Yeah. I was actually talking with Nick from Red Hat, and they're kind of interested maybe in sponsoring that work, but I've been too busy so far. But maybe, yeah, that's something we could do and you know, fix a lot of Python packaging stuff. But the problem is that, you know, there's the question when, how, where this static metadata, you know, it's good that this goes upstream and you know, where would, you know, if we could solve a lot of problems in our ends, but that wouldn't go upstream, and that's kind of problematic because upstream in Python, it's not as bad as like in JavaScript where releases happen a lot of times, but it's still pretty fast, and you don't want to maintain that in Nick's you know, ecosystem. So it has to be a community effort. So there is a lot of work to be done in this area actually to come to sanity. Yeah, one more thing.
Ah. Yeah. So yeah, thanks for the talk. It still sounds like the Python situation in general is still a little bit of a mess despite all the improvements from the last couple of years. And I was wondering, seeing that in the Haskell community, this has driven a lot of people towards Nix coming from Haskell because of the packaging situation in their ecosystem. Do you see any movement of Pythonistas towards Nix for similar reasons?
Yeah, so in Python, you know, unfortunately, well, for us, there is like a Conda package manager built in Python, which is pretty much a clone of Nix written in Python, and I've talked to the original developer when I was at the Python conference, you know, like why split this effort, and they basically said that we want to support Windows with Cygwin, which is a bad idea, and even Guido said that officially, the author of Python. So what Conda does differently is they have separate specification for Windows and Unix. They maintain both at the same time, so Windows has like native support, and of course the same could be done in Nix if Nix, you know, was ported to Windows natively, but unfortunately, you know, they're doing it their way, and they even got a big investment right now, so you know, it's gonna, I think at the end we have a better ecosystem, but it's gonna take more time to show up basically, and to convince people.
Okay, any further questions? We would still have 5 minutes. Otherwise, I think we could start the break and to see each other again at, I think it must be 11:15. Yes, I guess the right number. So thanks a lot. See you soon.